I mean, it's perfect timing because you've just launched an enterprise large language model that's also going to be deploying DeepSeek more broadly. But talk us through exactly what it entails.
Well, I think China had its ChatGPT moment when DeepSeek came out. We can call it DeepSeek moment. Everyone's aware of it over the Chinese holidays. Everyone's talking about it. And the CEOs came back to work saying, put DeepSeek to work at my company. And what they found out was DeepSeek is a fantastic model, amazing AI, but it doesn't have the middleware and the user interface that it takes to connect to corporate databases, to build applications, to make it useful for HR, finance, and customer service. So what 01.ai did was we saw DeepSeek has been making great momentum, and we decided to really bet on DeepSeek and build that missing middleware and UI so that DeepSeek can be made useful in corporations. That's the product we announced this Monday, and we're getting fantastic reception in China and also in Hong Kong.
Tell us more about that launch.
So we launched on Monday, yeah. And what we talked about was many of you have DeepSeek now. You love to use it. In fact, one CEO friend of mine asked his employees, what do you use it for? And
good question.
And the answer was fortune telling. By the way, that's a great thing to try for you. But yeah. But it's not very deep into the industry, the company. You know, okay. Every company has ERP and the CRM databases. They have employee records. They have their internal information. Mm-hmm. And they want the model to be more a generalist. They want it to be knowledgeable. Bloomberg would want a finance knowledgeable model, right? Ping An would want an insurance knowledgeable model. So our job is to really build that layer for that purpose. It's sort of like if I gave you a Windows kernel that is the core operating system, you wouldn't know what to do with it. You need all the Windows layer, the application interfaces, so that the Windows kernel can be useful. And we like to think that 01.ai is providing that layer for DeepSeek, which is the underlying model and technology.
And using DeepSeek as the underlying model, I mean, obviously, you could have chosen other models instead, including from the U.S. What does that tell you about where the competition or the race for supremacy stands between China and the United States right now?
Well, clearly, in both U.S. and China, the pre-training of a giant model has consolidated and is consolidating. And it's become clear that open source will be the winner. There's still many that will not concede. Right, OpenAI, Anthropic, who build their businesses believing they can build a better closed model than everyone else, I think they got shocked when they saw a model as good. They would argue nearly as good, but either way, they're getting it for much, much lower cost. If you think about OpenAI's cost of $7 billion of operating costs in 2024, DeepSeek probably operated with 2% the operating expense. So the issue really isn't whose model is 1% better. I think they're all very good. But the issue is OpenAI's model even sustainable, right? I mean, you're spending $7 billion a year making a massive loss, and here you have a competitor coming in with an open source model that's for free. And that company also is infinitely lasting because this founder has enough money to fund it at the current level and has reduced the cost of computing by a factor of 5 to 10. So with that kind of formidable competitor, I think Sam Altman is probably not sleeping well.
Yeah, well, you do think. I mean, obviously, the DeepSeek would have really challenged some of the monetization strategies around AI. But at the same time, given that AI is so commoditized now, and in China as well, that open source approach, how many AI models do you think that the Chinese market can actually sustain?
Well, I think probably, I'm guessing three, DeepSeek, Alibaba, and ByteDance. And they'll evolve over time, right?
Okay, you don't, there's a few names missing on that list.
Yeah,
three.
Well, there will be many other who aspire to build one,
right?
And we'll see if there's a fourth player. Mm. But even within these three, I think DeepSeek currently has the momentum, and that's why we're embracing that. But I also want to point out that I wouldn't say AI is commoditized. I would say the underlying pioneer model, foundation model that is trained with a huge amount of money is commoditized. Mm. It costs a lot and it's hard to really compete with open source. Mm. But AI is not commoditized, right? It's like, you know, Windows kernel, Linux kernel, that's kind of commoditized. Right. But Windows is not commoditized. Mm. Microsoft makes a ton of money. And what 01.ai wants to do is build Windows and use DeepSeek as our Windows kernel.
Mm. And is that where you think the value added comes now? In other words, for VCs thinking about where the value added is in this industry, it's no longer, for example, AI, for example, still presents that value. And I want to understand, for example, the economics and why you think, say, there's only room for three as well.
Well, there may be room for four, but in most markets, you end up with room only for two, right? The winner who makes a ton of money, the runner-up who breaks even, and everyone else who dies. And this one is exacerbated because it's hard to monetize the underlying pioneer model. But once you are the winner, there are many ways to monetize it.
Right.
So that's the trick. For the VCs in both US and China are moving away from wanting to fund more pioneer models. They're happy to fund AI infrastructure, AI applications, consumer apps, because every app will be remade, right? And also enterprise apps that can provide real value add to enterprises. So AI funding is going gangbusters. It's just that nobody wants to fund pioneer models. Mm.
Does China's innovation, though, come up against the headwind this year of greater restrictions on China's access to advanced semiconductor technology? Is that going to end up presenting a problem?
So we can look at historically, right? China is able to catch up and build great engineering products while US is better at making breakthroughs. That was what I argued in AI superpowers, and that continued to be the case. The GPU sanctions came 2 years ago, and today we actually see DeepSeek not only resilient, competitive, but also basically made true the statement that necessity is the mother of innovation. Mm-hmm. That because they had so few GPUs, they had to make it 10 times more effective. So I think I would argue that the sanctions so far hasn't worked. Mm-hmm. It's hard to project the future. But I would say that DeepSeek actually benefited from having less resources and able to make training and inference at 5 to 10 times lower the expense incurred by OpenAI and others.
You know, I remember, so DeepSeek was, what date is it? March 20, so let's call it 2 months ago. I remember we had the chat on the show, I think it was back in October, where you guys actually launched something similar mm-hmm. months before DeepSeek. And so you guys came out, DeepSeek came out, and then since DeepSeek came out that moment, just the cadence and the frequency of all these ones coming out with their own iterations of it. I guess my question is, what do you make of the frequency? What is behind, you think, the frequency of these releases? Mm-hmm. And is DeepSeek the symptom or is it the cause of what's going on? In other words, what can we expect from the industry this year?
I think it's still ultra competitive. The fact that I think China will have three winners, US might have four winners at the end, doesn't mean dozens of others will not want to compete. So I do expect frequent releases to continue especially from the fast moving companies. And I think the fastest moving companies probably are XAI's Grok and DeepSeek. I'd say these are the fastest. Mm. And then I think OpenAI, Alibaba, Google, and Anthropic are, of course, all making respectable moves. I listed ByteDance because they're not on the list by people, but we know how much they're spending. And I think one way you can justify spending a ton of money on pioneer models is because you have so many customers that when amortized over many, many customers, you can make the business case. And ByteDance has more customers and more ways to monetize than anybody. So I would make that speculation.
Yeah, I think Baidu is one of the names that sort of stands out to me, not on that list, and maybe you can share some reaction on that. But also government support from Beijing. Exactly how do you see that also shaping up over the coming year?
Well, we all respect and thank Baidu for really starting the transformer revolution in China. They tried to hire Jeff Hinton and ended up hiring Andrew Ng And I think that shows that Robin has that kind of vision. The execution is currently lagging, and we'll see what happens. And your other question was?
Government support.
Government support, right. So the Chinese government's new big direction is called new quality productivity. What that means is using high tech to create productivity, efficiency, and really turn all the traditional industries into more profitable, more competitive by the use of high tech, and AI is at the very core of that.
Actually, sorry, final question for you. Sorry, because you mentioned the word consumption in AI was actually mentioned in Premier Li Qiang's work report from the MPC, and to the support, the point that Mel was making on, you know, government support, it was rare that we saw just, you know, the CEOs of China's big tech companies in the same room as the president, for example, weeks before that. And I'm wondering from a tangibly, what measures do you think we could see from the government to be able to back up, really, what really seemed as very, very good optics?
Yeah, I think right now the local governments probably are the most active in trying to see, you know, I'm City X, I'm the, you know, party secretary of mayor of City X, and this city is very strong in the following industries. How would I apply AI to create this new quality productivity in these industries that will end up helping the growth, the GDP of the city? And I think, you know, having a single direction from the top, new quality productivity, is very effective and invigorating to the cities. And we're seeing a lot of interest for our company and our peer companies to work more closely with these local cities.